Hello, and thank you for joining. I'm Julianne Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. Empowering staffing owners through education, resource, and expertise is one of the many things I'm extremely passionate about. That is why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, challenges, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I have the pleasure of Tom Erb joining me. With a staffing recruiting career spanning over 25 years, Tom has established himself as one of the industry's top subject matter experts. He is one of the most highly sought after national speakers in the staffing industry, presenting a variety of industry organizations, including American Staffing Association, National Association of Personnel Services, TechServe Alliance, and a dozen of state and regional staffing and recruiting conferences. Tom is also the author of Winning the Staffing Sales Game and writes the monthly column Recruiting Today for ASA Staffing Success magazine. He is a former president of the Ohio Staffing and Search Association and the Human Resource Association of Central Ohio, is past chair for the National Association of Personnel Services and former chair and current member of ASA's Professional Managerial Sectional Council. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Tom Erb. Welcome, Tom.
Thanks, Julianne. Thanks for having me.
No, thank you. It's always great to have you on this and talking about the industry, especially the state of the industry in 2024, after we just got to 2023. Shut that door.
Yeah. That's right.
Shut that door. I want to start with something from Wall Street Journal that was posted January 1st, 2024. Where is the job market heading for 2024? So I'm just going to read this and I'll let you take it from here. It said, by the end of 2023, workers had stopped job hopping as much, while employers hired less but kept layoffs low. Job growth became more concentrated in healthcare and social assistance, leisure and hospitality, state and local government. Temporary hiring had been on a downward slope for more than a year. What's to come of 2024? What is, Tom?
Well, first of all, I think that's a really good summary that Wall Street Journal has there. I think they nailed all the areas. I've been saying this for a while, and I'm more convinced than ever as we come out of 2023 that it was an overcorrection. It wasn't a downturn. If you take a look, jobless claims have stayed pretty low, and they've started to drop again, but they even stayed low last year, even when there wasn't as much demand for staffing for temporary employment and recruiting services. When I say it's an overcorrection, it's a typical one of those situations, kind of like when you're driving on the interstate and all of a sudden everybody comes to a stop and then they speed up a little bit and then they stop again and speed up a little bit, and you're going, oh geez, there must be a wreck or something up there, and there never is, right? And then all of a sudden it speeds up again. It's the same thing, is that people were starting to get cautious because they were hearing the word recession over and over again. They were seeing interest rates going up, seeing inflation going up. And so they started pumping the brakes, just like you see on the interstate. And then when they pump the brakes, then others pump the brakes. And it's, you have this effect of, at the highest level, you've got, not that the jobs were being eliminated or they weren't looking for people, but they were slowing the process down. They were pumping the brakes on hiring. And that has this trickle down effect that comes all the way down to staffing providers. So I think that was one overcorrection that we saw. And we're already starting to see us come back out of that. And by the way, the data completely supports that. If you take a look at Lightcast, is a great place to find data for the labor market. And it shows that if you look at non-staffing job postings versus staffing job postings, the non-staffing job postings did not decrease nearly at the rate that staffing job postings did, which was the other overcorrection, which is you had a lot of companies coming out of COVID, particularly healthcare organizations that were coming out of COVID and were going, we feel like we got gouged. We were getting squeezed in the middle, and we're going to take this back in-house because we feel like it's softening up. We feel like there's people coming back into the labor market. I don't know where they were coming from, but they feel like they're coming back, right? Wherever back is. Mm-hmm. And so they tried to do it on their own, which is why you saw the numbers stay more flat around job postings with non-staffing companies. Now companies are realizing what they knew before, which is they can't consistently do that. And so we're seeing in more and more pockets where the job openings are coming back for staffing companies, recruiting firms are getting more searches. So, yeah, I'm always bullish. I'm always optimistic, but it's played out the way we kind of thought it would. And if you just really pay attention to the economic data, it really points, I think, to a very strong 2024.
Good. It's interesting. I had a board meeting yesterday, and because I'm part of a bank, they always look to us to be the indicator of a recession, right? So yeah. Last year, they're like, oh, we're going in. You guys are the indicators. And then yesterday I was talking to them and I read, the Wall Street Journal, as well as the Express Employment Professionals had a posting on the 10th. I don't know if you saw that, about how the hiring was exactly what you're saying. Because so many companies, corporations, companies, the warehousing, the industrial had not increased. They laid off. They didn't do layoffs as much as they didn't just rehire when people left.
Right.
And that, a lot of them said they're going to 51% were going to, or was going to fill jobs, create new jobs. And it was all these different percentages. So I was talking about, and they're like, well, Julianne, so is there a recession or what's going on? I go, well, I'm not an economist.
Right.
But I don't think this was really this was not really a whole recession this time. We weren't really the indicator this time. This was a whole different situation. And you're right. It was really the whole correcting that needed to happen.
Right. Well, Bullhorn came out with their, they have their numbers that come out as far as temporary staffing usage. And in December, they came out that we were down as an industry by, I believe it was 12% overall, but only 4% in professional staffing. And if you take out healthcare staffing, which was down by a lot of measures, 25 to 35%, the other verticals really were not down that much, not to the point where you would say that there was a recession, a typical recession. When you take a look at temporary staffing is also a canary in the coal mine kind of industry. And we were down, but again, I think it was an overcorrection. I think it was people pumping the brakes. It was fear of a downturn, fear of a recession was causing people to act a certain way. And I think that we've gotten beyond that. I just saw a really funny survey, and I always laugh at whenever they survey economists, I always laugh. The latest survey was 56% of economists surveyed think that we're going to go into a recession this year. That you're 6 points away from being 50-50, right? I mean, so half of economists think we're going to, half don't. They do that enough, they'll be right sometime, right? So you say you're an economist. I say that all the time. I'm not sure it really matters that much.
Yeah, right. I will never say I am. What about the wage pressure? How do you feel about that right now? I'm feeling like we're seeing that loosen up a lot, but not in some professional sectors. We're feeling it still, or seeing it still in the finance and accounting, because there's such a shortage there, it seems to be.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely has flattened from what everything we've seen across different industries, including the staffing and recruiting industry on our own internal positions. We had a lot of wage inflation this time last year. There was a bit of a feeding frenzy going on that was fueling that, particularly towards the end of 2022 and into 2023. Had all these great things about the great resignation and all that. So all of that, from what I've seen, has really slowed down. And we've even seen in some cases where companies have started reducing pay again. Now, I think that's a different type of overcorrection that probably shouldn't happen, but definitely we're not seeing the wage inflation, the last 6 months or so that we saw previous to that. So I think we've got a little bit beyond that. There will continue to be some wage inflation, I think, that goes on just along. I think there's going to be some additional, if inflation continues to stay at elevated levels, then you'll probably see some additional wage inflation, but not to the extent we saw beginning of last year.
Yeah, there was a lot of it last year. Both of us work with a lot with our clients on helping them with their businesses. And a lot of the questions, even, you know, last year and still today, are what should I be doing with my business? It's still down. What can I be doing? I know what I'm telling them. I love to hear what is the advice you're giving your clients that they should be looking at their business right now and doing prior to any uptick?
Get in a time machine, go back a few years and focus more on selling, right? But we can't do that. So, we should always be selling and always be recruiting. And we should never take our foot off the gas. And what I've seen over and over and over again is that with most staffing and recruiting firms, it is an either or. They're either focused on recruiting and sales slides, or they're focused on sales and recruiting slides. And we need to really be focused on that. It's the three-legged stool, right? You need all three legs, and that would be the fulfillment, which is part, recruiting is part of the sales, and then the operations piece of that, mm-hmm. solid foundationally, back office and internal hiring and all that stuff. So you really got to be sound in all three of those areas and constantly do it. We have seen that just about without fail, that the staffing companies that took a bigger hit last year didn't have as strong of a sales team put together, or sales structure, sales approach, sales methodology. There were exceptions to that, so I'm not saying it was 100% correlation, but certainly companies that had continued selling even when we had lots and lots of orders that we couldn't fill, they were ahead of the game more than the ones who took their foot off the gas. Or you heard a lot a year ago or 2 years ago now, I guess, of people saying, why would I sell? I can't fill the jobs I have now. Well, that very quickly swung the other way and they weren't prepared mm-hmm. for it. So my advice is get out there and sell, get out there and don't stop. Mm-hmm. And don't stop recruiting while you're at it. Keep recruiting.
Right.
This is actually a great time to be recruiting. I get a lot of pushback right now that, we don't have the jobs to offer people. It doesn't matter. Call them. This is what you wanted in a lot of respect, which is, let's talk to them when there's not as much demand for these candidates, when they're maybe more open to talking to us. We can build up some pools of talent. We can build up our network and be prepared for when the jobs come back.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And for niche markets, are there any new opportunities that you're seeing out there? Any new niches that you're seeing started?
We're seeing a lot. I would say probably the biggest things are AI. Seeing more and more around AI, more and more around, cybersecurity, those types of things. So right. particularly on the technology side. So I would say those are the big areas as far as new niches. I mean, everything else is kind of, I'm sure there's others I'm missing, but mm-hmm. those are the big hot ones right now. Right.
It's funny you bring up AI because we've now gotten into it. I mean, we're using ChatGPT, just chat all the time with our salespeople now, how to record yourself and watch it over and let it evaluate your sales team. And so what have you learned from that are you using that to educate your clients on that?
Yeah, I mean, we're figuring out all the different ways that we can leverage AI to mm-hmm. to try and help scale people, but also to just, refine messaging. On the recruiting side, there's all sorts of AI that's coming out that can help you source candidates real effectively, that can help really do the front end of the selection process, the recruiting and sourcing and selection process. There's a lot of there's voice chat AI that's out there that's getting better and better and better all the time. There's AI that will go out and scan candidates and will engage with them via text or chat and to the point of evaluating if they're good enough to go to a live recruiter to be considered for certain positions. And then just, I tell people, if you just want to dip your toe in AI, you use ChatGPT or Bard. Mm-hmm. Or Copilot now is gaining a lot of traction as Microsoft is rolling that out as part of the Microsoft Office 365 suite and integrating that more and more. Pretty soon you're going to have this Copilot, truly an AI Copilot, that is going to be with you as you're creating spreadsheets and presentations and everything. But use ChatGPT and Bard for things such as rewriting resumes, right? If you talk to a candidate and in the past, it's like a candidate sends you a really bad resume and they may be a great candidate, they just are bad at putting together a resume, and you would either give it back to them and say, go get this resume done, or you would spend an hour putting it together to get it to a point where you could present it to a candidate. Well, now you can throw it into ChatGPT or Bard and say, rewrite this, make it more appealing, and you can modify it and give it different prompts. And then you go back to the candidate. You always go back to the candidate and say, are you okay with this? Right. Mm-hmm. Get their approval. But that's one way to do it. Just making better job postings, because all the job postings are so job description focused, so employer requirement focused. And a really easy way that you can differentiate yourself in job postings is just have more candidate-centric, more marketing, more appealing job postings. So you can take a job posting you get from a client or a job description, throw it into ChatGPT or Bard or one of the other AI tools, and in seconds it spits something out and you can ask it to redo it or whatever. That's just tip of the iceberg kind of stuff that can be done, but it's really easy to do. It's free. It saves you time, and it can also just introduce people to what the potential of AI is. So it's like, AI is nowhere near. The more I use AI, the more I realize that we got an awful long ways to go before it starts replacing people,
right,
much less taking over the human race. Mm-hmm. So it's in a lot of ways, it's still very simplistic and they're still figuring it out, but it's getting better and it's going to be just standard soon. And if you're not using AI, then you're falling behind because your competitors are using it.
They're definitely using it. Right. I agree with you. Yep. I finally have my sales team using it.
On the sales side, we've
used it,
On the sales side, we've done it. You can do things like, give me a quick overview of this company. If we're going to go talk to a prospect, we can have it go out there and just give me a quick overview. You can have it, we've used it where, we've gotten an email from a prospect and didn't quite know how to respond to it. Well, you can throw it into one of the AI tools and say, give me some different ideas on how I could best respond to this, and then make the sentiment professional yet empathetic or something to that effect. So there's a lot of different things that you can do along those lines.
Right. I mean, for us, we had to go with a $20 version a month, but who cares? I mean, at $20 a month, it's great. It's well worth it for using it for your sales team. So I had no problem doing that. I'm going to switch gears a little bit with you. What is your take on the industry? I think my view for this year for mergers and acquisitions, it's going to be a hot year for it. It seems like you've got a lot of companies that I've seen that, again, we went down in sales last year, weren't prepared for it. A lot of owners have a habit of taking everything out of that business, don't save for the rainy day. And so now they're going to be primed for selling. So what's your take on what you're going to see in the industry this year?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was a more active year last year than it had been the last several years. But we're getting to a point in the industry, which is not atypical of other industries, where we've got a lot of owners that are in their 50s and 60s and 70s and are starting to think about what they want to do next with it. And maybe they don't have a second or a third generation that wants to take it over. And so they're definitely looking at options. And then you couple that with the fact that 2023 was a tough year for a lot of people. And it's like, okay, it's almost like a rebuilding kind of year. Is, you know, do I want to go through that again? Do I want to rebuild? This is getting hard to sell again, right? And do I want to take that on? I think margins have been squeezed for a lot of people. They weren't making as much money. And then I think also, with some companies, PPP and ERC, those nest eggs that got built up with some of those have been diminished. And so I think that on the selling side, that it is going to be a more active year. I think the next few years are going to be more active. We're already seeing that. We just saw a huge acquisition just this past week. So I think we're going to start. I think we're going to see more of that in the next couple of years. It'll be a little bit different though, because also what we've seen too is private equity has pulled back for the last few years. It was heavily, the acquisitions were heavily driven by private equity, and we've seen them pull back a little bit because, you know, they maybe weren't getting the returns that they thought they were going to get in the industry. So
that'd be interesting, right?
Yeah.
Great. Legislation has been very impactful to our industry in certain states. More than others, but it definitely is something to be watching. I just had an article. Cranes just interviewed us. Actually interviewed me, and it was posted about 2 weeks ago in Chicago on getting involved in your state association or your legislation, being aware of what's going on. And so you're very involved in Ohio. You've been involved in Ohio. It's one of the messages that I've been pushing this last couple of years, and we are focusing more and more on it over this year. I want to talk about that. Is our viewers really need to understand that your association, both the state association and the national association, are huge help to us. And like in Wisconsin, we were trying to tell them, we're on the right side right now, but if they do what they're going to do, where they're going to lay out and rechange the whole state, we're going to go left.
Yeah.
And then everything that's going on in Illinois and Minnesota is going to come into our state. And if we don't get a PAC fund together now, and we don't start making those inroads into the legislators and start getting them to understand our business, we're going to have problems.
Right.
So what is your view on that?
I'm completely there with you. There are certain states that are able to generate all sorts of PAC money, and it's because they have horrible, onerous legislation that's coming all the time. And our industry, just like I'm sure many others, waits until there's bad stuff to really pay attention to the legislation. Ohio has been, for the most part, an employer-friendly state for pretty much the whole time I've been in the industry, but we've also been hit with bad stuff over the years. They've tried to introduce stuff around to regulate healthcare staffing in the past couple of years. You know, we were able just a couple of years ago to get our staffing sales tax, the sales tax on staffing services, eliminated here. We'd been working on it for over 20 years, and it was passed in the middle of the night. In a super secret session, and all of a sudden now we've got a charge sales tax, which, by the way, we were only one of a handful of states at the time that had to do that. So we've been fighting it for forever, and finally got it repealed a couple of years ago. But that's in a state that's pretty business friendly. We had that kind of stuff happen. So you're right. You need to be proactive on it. You need to be involved in legislation. If you're in a state that is business friendly or is neutral and is fairly positive for the staffing industry, you need to be strengthening those relationships. You need to be donating to the state PAC if they have one. And I'm a huge believer of it. I've just seen firsthand the positive that can be done when it is a positive environment for staffing. And then also just the negative stuff that is done when some horrible legislation comes along, misguided or just, in some cases, I think intentionally vindictive of the industry, you know. So anyway, you got to be involved in the pack. Right. Don't wait for it to get bad, because then it's too late.
And get involved in your association, your state association. I can't stress that enough, but I think it's really
absolutely
critical. I mean, we're involved in like 15 to 16 associations, and we belong to numerous packs we contribute to. And it's because of, we believe in this industry, and we want to support it. So if we're doing it, the owners of staffing owners need to be doing it. And so that's my message this year, is really trying to get more people involved in the association locally in the state. And then,
And I've been involved in the Ohio Staffing and Search Association for a very longer than I want to admit, but it's been, you know, 25 years probably. So I did admit it. I'm involved in it because I believe in it, and because I get a lot out of it. And yes, I've put a lot into it over the years, but I've gotten a lot more out of it than I put into it. You know, don't leave it up to your competitors and your peers to run the association for your state. You need to be involved in it, and you need to be active. And if nothing else, just be an active member, because there's great content. I go to these, you go to them too. We go to these conferences all across the country. It is national level talent that is speaking at these conferences for, you know, a really good value.
Right.
And yeah, you know, you don't have to travel much, if at all, if it's in your state. And you know, there's just so many benefits to being involved in the associations, and such a small fraction of our industry is actually involved in either the state or one of the national associations. So, you know, look at the American Staffing Association, the National Association of Personnel Services, which I've been actively involved in both for many years. And again, I've gotten so much out of them, but I get different stuff out of them than I do out of the state and the local and regional ones. It's different. So I highly encourage involvement.
And what I always like is, at most, I see it probably at all the state associations, you will get the national, like a Toby, to come in, Millar, and to talk about what's going on. And he does a great job at telling you what's going on with your state, but then how it also what's going on nationally and how it's going to impact everybody else. And I love that about him.
Yeah.
He does a phenomenal job at that.
And one thing that he says, or another speaker says, can 10 times overpay for going to that conference, right? Exactly. Just one little thing that you walk away from. You know, don't be isolated in being a staffing company trying to figure all this stuff out. There's resources out there where you can learn from others. You don't have to do trial and error all the time. You can learn from what others are saying, your peers. There's as much or more value in just interacting with your peers. And quite frankly, we're not UPS and FedEx, right? We have hundreds of competitors in our markets in a lot of cases, and none of them are really direct. So I hear these, oh, well, I don't want to network with my competitors. Well, it's not like that. It's not like, you know, your Coke and Pepsi's there. We're talking about companies that in most cases, most of them you never even run across. So, and you can in many times work together. You can subcontract, you can pass off, you know, positions that you don't work on and they do, and vice versa. I mean, there's all sorts of opportunities. So
I love when they network together like that, when they share and they work, they team together. We try to do that a lot with our clients, have them team together. So that's great.
Absolutely.
We've given some great advice. I should say you've given some great advice. Any other advice that you're giving staffing clients today of yours that seem to be working for them in this state that we're in?
The biggest thing is that accountability is a good word, not a bad word. And I always talk about the three levels of performance management. And the first level is visibility, which is we can see the data. And most staffing companies can do a pretty good job of this now. They can get it from their ATS. They can get it from, you know, their voiceover IP call records. They can get it from their CRM or other places. So visibility, most have, at least they can have visibility to the data. And then the second level is responsibility. Do does everybody in your organization know what success looks like and what the expectations are for that individual position? Right. So, you know, I am, as an owner or a leader of an organization, I am happy with your performance if you do this. Do they know that? Do they understand that? That that's how they're being measured and that's the expectation. And then the highest level is accountability. And that's where most staffing companies really struggle, is that level of accountability. I've got clients that, you know, they have their employees turn in weekly reports. So they have the visibility, they have the responsibility. And somebody can turn in their report that they miss their numbers every single week for the next 5 years and nothing happens. So there's no accountability. And then when that happens, of course, then everything else is discounted, right? There's no credibility to it. But that's not fair to your employees, because if they don't know what success is, or they're not being held to success, they're never going to achieve what they need to achieve. And one, a lot of times their compensation plans are tied to achieving certain things, but if we're not helping them, showing them a path to success, they're not going to fully realize financially what they could. And then the other thing too, is just not knowing if you're being successful or not in your job isn't very fulfilling. It's not very much fun, right? You know, when I ask people, what, you know, how do you know if you had a successful day? You know, most people can't answer that question. They haven't even really thought about it. And so, you know, we all have had busy days where we've gone, geez, I was busy, but I didn't get a thing done, right? Mm-hmm. Well, if you don't have any goals, then every day is like that.
Right. Right.
And you just kind of let the day dictate what you're doing. So I would say that the number one biggest thing is accountability. Just hold people accountability, because it's in the company's best interest, but it's in their own individual best interest too.
I love that when you said accountability is a good word, not a bad word.
Yes, it is.
I'm going to remember that, right? It is.
Yeah.
It is.
Well, here's the thing. You know, let's say you've got a recruiter, for instance, and that recruiter is continuously not doing the stuff that they need to do to be successful. And you're not happy with how they're producing. Okay, they're not even paying for themselves in that seat. But we haven't told them any of that, right? We haven't told them, hey, listen, you really got to hit your activity numbers. If you hit your activity numbers, you're going to get enough submissions. And if you get enough submissions, you'll get enough placements and you'll hit your numbers. That's not fair to them to hold them to this result if we're not holding them accountable to the activity to get them to the result. Mm-hmm. And if we're not really focused on that at all. So it's just not fair to them. And so yeah, accountability is a good word. It's not a bad word.
Great. And I love the three: visibility, responsibility, accountability. Wrote them all down. I'm good. taking that back yes. As I do our goals for each of my management team, as each of them do their goals for the year. That's really good. I love that. Well, I don't know if you have anything else that you want to end with today. This has been great. Great discussion. Good. Anything you have for us? Any nugget of information?
Just, I would plan for 2024 to be a big year. And, you know, there's the old adage of, you know, whether you believe you can, you believe you can't, you're right. And you got to believe you can. And, you know, most of the people that are listening to this podcast are not a big five publicly traded company that has to move mountains to get their numbers to improve. You know, most of us have a relatively small or a very small piece of the pie, which makes it easier to go and get more of the piece of the pie. And so, but we got to be aggressive and we got to be purposeful and strategic about what we're doing. But I would really focus on 2024 being a good year and just go after it and have that mindset throughout your entire company. We're going to have a great year and they'll have better results.
Great. That's great advice. I appreciate it. Thank you. Well, that concludes this month's podcast with State of the Industry. I'd like to thank you, Tom. It's been great talking with you. I think you had some great insight to and information and great, great advice to our listeners. I hope to see you in Las Vegas at SI Executive Forum, and maybe some of our listeners or many of the other state associations that we both attend many times throughout the year, is right. We will be at many of them throughout the year.
Oh, yeah.
Until then, thank you for joining Insight with Insiders.